evening and welcome to May 27th, 1941. My name is Henry Chapp, your host. Stick around for about 30 seconds and I will tell you what we are going to listen to tonight. If you enjoy the content of this channel, not only subscribe, but please donate to its upkeep. Because of the vintage radio, music, and films that we share, this channel does not qualify for YouTube monetization. Help motivate us to consistently post this wonderful content. We like to think that this channel is more interesting and entertaining than any other World War II channel on YouTube. Help us keep going by donating. In the expanded description section to this video, you will find two links for which to donate. One is for PayPal and the other is for a GoFundMe. If the GoFundMe link is outdated on this video, go to this channel's description or our latest video where you will find an updated link. Any little bit helps. Boy, there is some very interesting newscast today. You are going to definitely want to listen to them if you are interested in history. That's one thing that I think is so cool about this channel is you get history and entertainment all rolled into one. Of course, the thumbnail to this video says the British are battling the Bismark, but the sinking would not occur yet. You are going to hear the commentary on the sinking through the news, basically. And of course, we are going to start things off with the NBC morning newscast. Then we are going to move right into the Goldbergs. Then we have H.V. Kaltenborn, who was the dean of the commentators. He was one of the longest airing commentators in radio and one of the most respected. Then we're going to have the next consecutive episode of Lum and Abner. By the way, the NBC newscast aired at 7 in the morning. The Goldbergs aired at 2:15 in the afternoon, and H.V. Kaltenborn aired at 5:15. Then we have the next consecutive episode of Lum and Abner, and Lum and Abner aired at 5:30 in the afternoon. So you would be going right from H.V. Kaltenborn right to Lum and Abner, just like in the old days. And then at 8:30 in the evening, we have one of the best primetime comedy shows, legendary, to air. And we have Fibber, McGee, and Molly, and Fibber visits a recording studio. And then we're going to get serious again at 9:30 in the evening. We have President Roosevelt and his fireside chat. And what's interesting about this fireside chat is he has a live audience. He has several delegates from the Latin American countries in his audience right there in the Oval Office with him as he's doing the fireside chat. So a lot of stuff going on as the United States is gearing up to go to war. It's still several months away, but Americans didn't know that. They just know that a lot of their boys are being drafted and for the defense of the country. And when you're listening to the president talk, you realize how important it is because, well, all their sons and husbands, their lives are in his hands, basically. There was a lot going on. The snowball is going to get bigger before it gets smaller. That's for sure. So right now, let's close your eyes and you are waking up, getting ready for work. Maybe you're shaving and you have maybe you have a portable radio in the bathroom with you, or maybe you're sitting at the breakfast table or tying your tie and you have, you know, getting ready to go out to the office, or you're getting the kids ready to go to school. School might still be in session. It might not be done yet, but you're getting whatever you're doing. You have your morning routine going on and you're listening to this on the news.
The battleship Bismark, the message says, has been sunk by our naval forces. Details of the operations, the communique continued, will be announced as soon as possible. The battle with the Bismark apparently raged since 9 o'clock last night, London time. She was apparently fleeing towards her base in a Norwegian port, and her interception was said to be the result of brilliant strategical moves by the Royal Navy. The sinking is greeted with great elation in London, and it is regarded as more than compensating for the loss of the Hood. The position in Crete is fluid, said the Australian War Minister, Mr. Spender, this morning. He revealed that the Germans continue to drop hundreds of parachutists. Despite desperate fighting is going on, he said. The internal unrest in both Syria and Iraq is rapidly approaching a breaking point. It is generally believed that General Dantz, governor of Syria, cannot hold the loyalty of French, Arabs, and Christians for Vichy much longer without assistance from Germany. The whole population is rising in revolt against the attempted sellout to the Nazis. In Iraq, Rashid Ali and his rebel band are moving northward along their only avenue of escape. Commander Stephen King Hall, MP, in a letter to the Times this morning, urges the immediate military mobilization of everybody and everything to put Britain on a total war footing. We must recognize at once, he said, that as this war increases in violence, this island will become an operational aerodrome for United States aircraft. The essence of our problem arises from the fact that 46 million people must live and work on this aerodrome and defend it against air attack and invasion. It must be explained to the people, he continued, that a German blitz is a military operation that can only be countered by defenses organized and operated on military lines. Civilian defense forces aren't good enough. The local authorities are naturally resisting further encroachments on their sovereignty by the national government. They maintain that there is now splendid cooperation with regional authorities established when war broke out for emergencies such as this. Those favoring centralized control seem to have the better of the functional argument. Local authorities are also said to have neglected or lacked funds to provide adequate emergency housing and feeding for people bombed out of their homes. The demand for centralized control also extended to industry. The House of Commons Select Committee revealed that 1,000 aircraft workers were idle in one factory while there was a shortage of labor in another. One industrialist told me the other day that centralized planning was the greatest weakness in war production. The skill of the workmen, he said, was excellent, and the equipment in factories superb. The problem was to keep a steady flow of labor and materials. With a decent planning organization, every factory manager, he maintained, ought to be able to concentrate solely on running his plant efficiently. He ought not to be worried by such things as bidding for contracts or begging for raw materials and labor. He suggested that the government purchasing agents in America had forgotten to buy one important thing, American efficiency engineers, who would take very little shipping space. President Roosevelt's speech tonight is given prominence in all the papers. The news that he would be revising his speech up to the last moment to include up-to-the-minute information has aroused much speculation. British correspondents' dispatches from Washington stress the fact that the speech is generally regarded as a landmark in American history. The average Englishman hopes the president may solve what to him has become the riddle of America. He notices the paradoxical effect that news from here has on the American people, or at least a certain portion of the people. I dare say that the Ministry of Information is also puzzled. When, for instance, a catastrophe occurs like the sinking of the battle cruiser Hood, the English hear the isolationists moan that all is lost and there is no sense in helping a beaten England. Now, when the Bismarck is sunk, will the isolationists, they think, say that help is unnecessary because Britain can manage the fight pretty well alone. I return you now to the National Broadcasting Company in New York.
And that's the report from London this morning. Tonight, at 10:30 Eastern Daylight Time, the President will address the nation. His fireside chat will be carried over the combined coast-to-coast networks of the National Broadcasting Company and will be heard in foreign lands via NBC's international shortwave stations. And now, continuing our roundup of European news on this morning, May 27th, let's hear from our American radio reporter in the Reich. Go ahead, Berlin.
Please. Hello, NBC. This is Charles Lanius in Berlin. The 35,000-ton German battleship Bismarck is said to be fighting a pitched battle with English warships in the icy waters of the North Atlantic. According to the German Supreme Command, the sea fight started last night at 9 o'clock, and it's presumed here that it's still going on. In the short high command bulletin, it's said that the Bismarck is again engaged in a heavy encounter with numerically superior enemy naval forces. Nothing is said about the units of the German naval squadron under the command of Admiral Legends, which was reported to be with the Bismarck when it sunk the 42,000-ton British battlecruiser Hood on Saturday. Nor is anything known about the British warships in battle with the Bismarck. It's surmised, however, that one of them may be the battleship of the King George class, which the Germans reported turned tail when the giant British battlecruiser was blown up. Here in this capital, there are no further details on the sea fight at present. We have only the brief 19-word high command statement to go on. But that's enough to set the German interest to swinging back and forth between the North Atlantic and the Mediterranean again. In the Eastern Mediterranean, it said, German Stuka scored a number of direct hits on a British aircraft carrier with heavy caliber bombs in a new aero-naval battle yesterday. The aircraft carrier was apparently sailing with a number of other British warships. Anyway, the Germans say that a cruiser in the same squadron was also hit directly by bombs. The exact location where the battle took place isn't stated. As for the actual battle on the island, new information is scarce. The latest German reports say that fighting is fierce and that their reinforced units are advancing further into the eastern part of the island. They are doing this with the help of German bombing formations. The Stukas, it said, are bombing British and Greek troop formations and have inflicted heavy losses. New troops and supplies, arms and ammunition are arriving hourly on the island, it said, protected by the German Air Force, which is apparently in complete domination of the air. The German radio carries a story said to have originated in England that about 20 German transport planes are landing in Crete every hour with men and weapons. The strength of the Germans, it's asserted, is growing visibly and rapidly. In the waters around the island, a number of British troop transports were hit by bombs yesterday, including one large vessel of 8,000 tons. In actions yesterday and the day before, several tankers were sunk, and one which was hit is reported to be still burning. The German pilots say they saw a British heavy cruiser completely burned out and a damaged British destroyer which had run aground on the coast. There's been some hard fighting in North Africa, too, according to dispatches here. In one action near Saloum, 60 British tanks were attacked by German bombers. It's claimed that the tank concentration was partly wiped out. At Tobruk, a large British flying boat is said to have been shot down. German bombers are reported to have accounted for two more British merchant ships, totaling 9,000 tons near the port. The ships are said to have been sunk by direct hits. In addition, a small British warship is reported to have been badly damaged by a bomb. The German Air Force was busy over England again last night. Several aeroplane factories are said to have been attacked at points in southern England. A field used to park completed British planes is reported to have been bombed so heavily that it'll be impossible to repair it. One of the British airplane plants was almost totally destroyed, according to the Germans. A number of harbors on the east coast of England and military objectives in all parts of the island, it's claimed, were attacked during the day yesterday. German long-distance bombers flew to an area east of the Orkneys, where it's reported they sunk a 3,000-ton tanker. At another point in the Atlantic, the German flying fortresses are credited with having sent a 4,000-ton merchant ship to the bottom. There were no British planes over Germany last night, according to the Germans. The latest news of the war waged against British shipping by German U-boats was released this morning. It's said that in an attack by several German submarines on convoys in the Atlantic, 77,000 tons of merchant shipping was sunk. Secretary Hull's remarks on yesterday's statement by Admiral Rader to the Japanese press drew some comment from Wilhelmstrasse officials this morning. An official said he couldn't understand how Hull could intimate that Rader's remarks should be a threat, not only to the United States, but also an attempt to scare other American republics. This is Charles Lanius in Berlin. I now return you to NBC in New York.
And that's the latest news on the war. Now, events at home, reported by Earl Godwin from our newsroom in Washington.
Good morning, folks. If you like little bits of history, this day in which the President of the United States will deliver his round-the-world radio chat, probably one of the most important announcements ever made on this side of the Atlantic. This day happens to be the birth date of Julia Ward Howe, who wrote the Battle Hymn of the Republic. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord, remember? And on the eve of the President's 16th talk to the people, here are two or three or several salient facts as they stack up here and are talked of by higher official officers, and they have something to do with the background of the president's speech. The British are by no means gaining. They are appalled by their sea losses in the Mediterranean. The loss of the Hood was a blow, not merely a shock, but a terrific loss in strength. And of course, the loss by the Nazis of the Bismarck is a compensating element, much discussed here, but not yet settled as to just what it means. The British are said to be now in sight of the end of their resources and strength as at present computed. Our officials at the top know that Britain will not collapse this spring or next fall, but next year unless they have active fighting help, so it is reported here in the highest official sources. The British need more help, more goods. They need actual delivery of the goods. So far, this government has not seen fit to tell the people who are paying the bill how many ships of American goods are being sunk and how many are getting there. And on Capitol Hill, in certain quarters of Congress, this is creating a sullen dislike for the whole situation. We seem actually to be at the point where we hear naval experts say they don't want the British fleet to fall into the hands of the Germans. That seems to me a little slow on the feet, maybe, to be a completely fantastic fear, but I repeat merely what I hear, that the British sea power is actually being knocked down in the Mediterranean of all places, according to reports, and according to further reports, may have to withdraw from that sea. And if so, Britannia rules the waves in a rather reduced area. The Japanese government makes threatening gestures and keeps on with them this morning. The Japanese let their spokesman say that if Uncle Sam uses convoys, that's a warlike move and the Japanese are bound to rush to Hitler's help. Now, they said that many times, but do they really mean it? And that's a part of the president's problem. Adolf Hitler has control of Europe and will have for some time to come. That's one of the official, unofficial statements that you can find among the higher officials if you know them. Hitler is reaching out for Africa and Asia, they will tell you, and that regardless of what the Nazi spokesmen say, the Nazi scheme includes the Western Hemisphere, South America, first. The president has all that as a close-up background of facts against which to write his speech and plenty more. At the same time, congressional isolationists are seeking to deflate the administration's foreign policy. First, they plan to send to the president a warning not to lead the country into a so-called undeclared war. And second, they are calling for a national referendum on the war issue. And Earl Godwin says goodbye. That's the news from Washington at this time.
And that's the news at home and abroad at this time. Keep tuned to this station throughout the day for good entertainment and first reports of events in this ever-changing world. This is the National Broadcasting Company.
Stay tuned next for The Goldbergs.
And now, The Goldbergs. Molly Goldberg is not going to feel safe again until she and her family are back home in Lastonbury. Meanwhile, she and Jake and Rosie nervously await Sammy's return from an automobile ride with Sylvia. Now that Sammy has definitely decided not to marry this girl who brought so much suffering and unhappiness into his life and into the lives of her family, the future should be brighter. But Molly's dread goes deeper than any promise Sammy could make. There's a certain brilliant wickedness about Sylvia that terrifies Molly, and Molly keeps talking and looking at the clock and wondering.
Rosalie, what time is it?
Mama, darling, you just asked me the time.
I want to know it again. I want to know it again, Rosalie, I said.
Ma.
Where's Papa?
He went to put oil and gas in the car.
Hmm. Was Mr. Allison?
Upstairs talking to his daughter, Leah.
Hmm. Rosalie, if they're going to leave soon, Rosalie, well, as soon as family comes in, but why didn't you wear something a little warmer for riding in the car?
This is all right until we get further north.
Hmm. I could only see myself in a different climate already. A very different climate.
Ma, if you'd only tell me what you're afraid of.
I don't want Sammy out of my sight. That's what I'm afraid of. What time is it?
Again, Ma?
Again, Ma. Rosalie, mm-hmm. Why is the button off your dress?
Where?
Where? Here.
Where?
There.
I'll fix it.
Why did you put it on without a button, wire?
Smart. Everything should have buttons, Rosalie. What's so important about a button?
What's so important? It means you're careless. I don't want carelessness. Carelessness in one thing extends itself to carelessness in everything else. I don't want it, Rosalie. I don't want you to be careless. I don't want it. Did you ever saw Mama without a button?
All right, Mama.
Did you ever saw Mama put on a dress shouldn't have hooks and shouldn't have eyes and shouldn't have zippers and shouldn't have buttons and shouldn't have buttons?
Ma, I said I'll fix it.
You shouldn't put it on.
Well, I didn't know.
No. Didn't you saw when you came to button the first button that the third button wasn't there? Is that the car coming, Rosalie? Hmm?
No.
Get me a needle and give me a thread.
Now?
Now.
This minute?
This second.
Where am I going to find a needle now?
That's Carabel.
She's upstairs with Mr. Allison, too. Cross-examining everybody.
How do you know?
I heard Carabel say so. And he's waiting for Ed, his son-in-law. He'll know everything. I wish we did.
I know everything I have to know. I know too much. I know everything I have to know. Where's Sammy? That's all I have to know now. That's all I have to know. Where's Sammy? Everything else I know. Plenty I know. More than plenty. Go up, Rose, and put on a different dress. I can't see you without the button.
I will later, Ma. I'll change my dress later.
Later. Everything is later. Everything is later. But I tell now everything is later.
Ma, please, where are you going?
Put on the button and get a button.
Oh, Lord. Hello? Yes? Yes.
I want to talk.
Ma, please.
Let me. Here. Who was it? What was it? Hello?
Hello, Ma?
Sammy? Sammy? See it? Sammy?
Yes, Ma.
Where are you?
I'll be back soon.
Oh, you'll be back soon?
Yeah, that's why I called you, Ma. I don't want Tamil, you to worry.
Tamil, listen, is everything well?
Everything's fine, Ma.
Yes?
Yeah.
I have nothing to worry about?
No, Ma, nothing.
Nothing. But keep it so, Tamil. Keep it so. Tamil, we're just waiting for you. Papa's gassing up, and he went to the garage. And they're fixing the carburetor. He said something was missing out.
Yeah?
And Tamil, we're ready to depart.
All right, Ma, all right.
All right, darling.
Now, let me talk to him, Ma.
All right. Rosalie wants to talk to you.
Okay, but hurry, please.
Sammy, Rosalie.
Oh, hello, you. Sammy.
Hello, Rosie.
Sammy, we can't stand it anymore. Please, wherever you are, get back right away.
Yeah, all right. Goodbye.
Goodbye, Sammy.
Now do you see you had nothing to worry about?
Mm-hmm. And you have a button off your own dress, Ma.
Like
that?
Uh-huh.
This?
Here? Oh, my. Oh, my. I'm sorry, Mama. You didn't mean to.
Come on now, Ma.
I didn't mean to. I've got a button off. I got a button off, too. Ed?
Shall I go upstairs and tell Mr. Thomas and his son-in-law is here?
Come in, Ed.
I think you're expected.
I know I am. I'll go up. Don't bother.
I was going up anyway.
Don't tell Mr. Allison I'm here yet. I want to speak to your mother first.
All right.
Well, there's nothing you have to say to me, Ed. And when I wanted to know, you didn't tell me. You see, now we're leaving. And thank you. I'd like to thank you before we go for trying to help me before. I mean, when you called before family came here to warn me. There wasn't anything I could do to keep family from coming here and learning from himself.
Maybe you're in too much of a hurry to take him back.
He wants to leave.
It's the atmosphere. Everybody catching hold of what they can and running.
After Sylvia did what she did?
What a person does, Mrs. Goldberg, and what they are two different things. Perhaps you're wiser than I am. And you can tell now what Sylvia is going to be 10 years from now.
I don't want to know. I'm just glad Tamily's safe. Far as Sylvia's concerned, let her learn and do what she can the way she can.
You mean she's bad? Irretrievably bad. And that you're afraid of her?
I'm afraid of her, yes.
Even if she is, what are you going to do? Just let her be? If the world is full of good people and bad ones, Mrs. Goldberg, and they never mix, what'll happen to the bad ones?
I didn't say the world was divided into good people and bad ones, Ed. People are mixed. People are good and bad together.
Sylvia loves Sammy.
I love him, too.
He loves her.
He does not.
He did.
He never was sure.
You're blinding yourself to the one fact that can make all the difference in Sylvia's life, Mrs. Goldberg. The fact that she loves Sammy, and that he can turn her into anything he wants.
I'm not blinding myself to the fact that the one thing Sammy shouldn't do is to tie himself to Ed. Sylvia to say... Oh, here's Mr. Allison. Talk to him, Ed.
What
changing people and saving them is not for young men like Sammy. It's enough that they can walk a little straight themselves. And when it comes to children, let the parents do the doing when something has to be done. Let Mr. Allison. Whatever Sylvia is, he's her father. Excuse me.
What were you telling her?
Something useless.
What was it?
That Sylvia should marry Sammy if he wants to.
He doesn't. And he came to me like a man and said so. But you, Ed, when you loved Sylvia, why did you marry Leah? Why couldn't you come to me and say, Mr. Allison, I love Sylvia? Why did you take Leah's life and ruin it?
I tried not to.
You tried? Did you try by remaining in love with Sylvia ever since? Up to this minute, including now?
That isn't true, Mr. Allison. No matter what I was and what I did, Mr. Allison, the truth is very simple now. The most important thing to me in the world is my family. Leah and the children. And all during my marriage, it was you, Mr. Allison. You. Who helped keep me separate and apart from them. You hated me because I wasn't one of these bright successes. Because I didn't care for the things that were most important in your life. Attitudes like that are like diseases. We all caught it. We can all cure it. And you can help all of us. I want you to talk to Leah for me.
All right. I'll talk to Leah for you. Maybe I can help you. Maybe I can help Leah. But what about Sylvia? She's also my child.
As far as Sylvia's concerned, don't let anyone or anything talk you into thinking she's just lost. Because if you act that way, you will lose her.
What do you mean, Ed?
I know Sylvia. You'll lose her in a way you won't forget for the rest of your life.
And suddenly, there is quiet and a kind of resigned calm in Allison's house.
Stay tuned next for H.V. Kaltenborn and the news.
Be sure with Pure. The Pure Oil Company presents H.V. Kaltenborn. Regardless of what you buy, you, like everyone else, appreciate more for your money. An extra, a plus value, something over and above what you actually pay for. And believe me, you get it when you use Pure Oil's famous solvenized gasoline, Pure Pep and Woco Pep. The explanation is simple. Here it is in a nutshell. First, solvenized Pure Pep and solvenized Woco Pep are top quality gasolines. Then, to every gallon, we add Pure Oil's exclusive chemical combination that combats excess carbon in your motor. It actually cleans as it burns. While you're driving, this chemical extra is helping that solvenized gasoline to give your car more power, more pep, better all-round performance. For these extra benefits, you pay no more. Solvenized Pure Pep and solvenized Woco Pep sell at the price of regular. Doesn't it all add up to a good common sense buy? Try it. Drive in tonight or first thing tomorrow at the big blue and white Pure Oil sign. Remember, it costs no more to be sure with Pure. Now, here's H.V. Kaltenborn.
Good evening, everybody. The important thing to remember in connection with the sinking of the German battleship Bismark is that she was discovered, pursued, located, and crippled by aircraft. Chief credit for finding the Bismark is given to an American-built PBY-5 flying boat. These planes have a cruising range of 5,000 miles, and like American bombers, need no convoys or patrols or shipping space to get them across the Atlantic. And today the President asked Congress for another $3.5 billion to manufacture more bombers and more flying boats. To build a Bismark takes over 4 years and costs something like $80 million. But the time will soon be here when a bomber can be completed in less than 4 months, and the bomber costs only $100,000. On the same day on which we hear of the sinking of the Bismark, Britain reveals that the Germans sank 4 cruisers and 2 destroyers with their bombing planes in the Battle of Crete. Here, too, superior air power was more important than superior sea power. Surface navies are still important, but sea power, without air power, has lost its historic might and mission. And in a crisis where speed is essential, bombers must precede battleships. Despite losses, the British Navy is still in action at Crete. It is reinforcing the British and preventing seaborne German forces from reaching Crete. But it does so at great risk. The Germans, with their control of the air, today report hits on several additional British warships. Fierce fighting continues in western Crete, where the Germans continue to have the upper hand. The British may have to give up the western half of the island and concentrate their remaining forces in the eastern half. Vichy today made a new pledge to the United States. A note delivered by the French ambassador pledges France will not surrender her fleet or her colonial empire to the Germans. But suppose the Germans take them as they took the Syrian air drones. Vichy is not a free agent, and we must remember that in appraising any promises Vichy may make. The dominant topic in Florida and Georgia, where I have just made a brief stay, is the power shortage. Everywhere, there are appeals to the public through poster, press, and radio to conserve power. An unprecedented drought, joined to an unprecedented defense demand, have created a critical situation. In many homes of the Southeast, the need to economize power will bring the first real sacrifice for defense. The private power companies of the Southeast are today eagerly looking towards the completion of new additions to that TVA power whose creation they once condemned as wasteful duplication. Today, every prominent power company of the Southeast is joining with the Tennessee Valley Authority in widespread advertisements urging everyone to economize in the use of electric current. Air conditioning may have to go. Daylight saving may be extended, and the sale and use of power-consuming appliances may be curtailed. Some 40 Georgia mayors will meet in Atlanta tomorrow to launch a United Save Kilowatts program. Chairman McDonald of the Georgia Public Service Commission says it has come down to a plain question of whether we will run our air-conditioned plants for comfort or build airplanes for our safety. In Pensacola yesterday, I visited the most complete naval air training station I have seen so far. The last time I saw Pensacola, it was a sleepy, charming little Gulf town. Its municipal transportation system consisted of one car, one mule, and one Negro driver. When the system met me on the main street, the driver hailed me. This was early in 1899, and I was a soldier in uniform. "Sergeant," he called, "do you all want a ride?" "Sure," I said, "but you're going the wrong way." "That's all right, boss," he answered. "I'll turn around." He unhitched his mule, hitched it to the other end of the car, and off we went. I thought of that first Pensacola ride yesterday as I enjoyed another in a huge Navy amphibian transport plane which carried me over 2 training stations, a Navy yard, 2 coast artillery forts, and some 30 airfields in a 15-minute flight around the shores of Pensacola Bay. Pensacola is an ideal base for naval aviation. It has the bay and the gulf for seaplanes, 30 strategically located landing and practice fields for land planes, and a deep water harbor big enough to hold the Atlantic Fleet. Hundreds of aviation cadets are arriving each month, and at Pensacola, they really learn how to fly. I was particularly impressed with the ground school training, which the boys don't like, but which is just as essential as learning how to fly. They have learned one thing at Pensacola, that you can save many a young flyer from failure by teaching his teacher how to teach. Not every good flyer is a good teacher. By teaching teachers and eliminating men unfit for teaching, the Pensacola station has reduced eliminations by 1/2. While I was waiting yesterday to board a naval plane, an aviation cadet. Landing on the field, jammed his brakes too hard and crashed. His plane nosed over on top of him. A siren sounded from the control tower, and in 30 seconds, an ambulance, a control car, and a wrecking car were alongside the plane. Within a minute, the cadet was on his way to the hospital for a checkup. And within 3 minutes, the wrecked plane was tilted right side to and on its way to the hangar. And all the time, scores of other planes took off and landed in routine fashion. I also visited Fort Barangas and Fort Pickens and saw the Army teach selectees how to shoot a 12-inch gun. Practically everything in the way of armament at Fort Pickens is out of date, but the Army has wisely decided to put this fort way at the bottom of the priority list. We don't propose to wait until an enemy sails into Pensacola Bay before tackling him. The men I saw training at Fort Pickens will soon man our new defense stations in the Caribbean, and someday they may be sent to islands even further out in the Atlantic. Ambassador Wynant is on his way home from London for important consultations. He reaches New York by clipper on Friday. He will bring important information and may carry important decisions back to London. Clipper service across the Atlantic makes possible those complete private man-to-man exchanges which even the transatlantic telephone cannot provide. Tonight, the president will speak to 130 million Americans by radio. No previous president has ever been able to do that at a time when this nation faced the risk of war. Few American presidents could have used radio with the persuasive skill of Franklin D. Roosevelt. But tonight, something more than skill and persuasion is needed and expected. We are waiting to hear what the president will say. We know that he will say it well. This speech would make history, no matter how poorly it might be delivered. But it comes at a turning point of one of the world's great wars, and it will outline, in more or less definite terms, the policy which this nation will follow towards that war. Many people believe we are already in this war. Others believe that we are committed to this war. Still others see definite and clearly defined limits to this commitment. There is still a considerable age short of war party which honestly believes that the president himself has it in his own hands to so limit and circumscribe our aid to Britain that we need not run the risk of war. 7 congressional isolationists, headed by Senator Wheeler, today sent a letter to the president warning him against the use of convoys and any direct naval action which might mean war. The president's answer was to call the congressional leaders of both parties to the White House late this afternoon for a review of the talk to the nation which he will deliver tonight. The isolationists had warned the president in their letter today that 80% of the people of the United States, quote, are opposed to any course which will take this nation into the European war, end quote. They remind him that under the Constitution, only Congress can declare war. But the letter of the isolationists says nothing about the Lend-Lease law, under which, by the vote of 3/4 of Congress, we are definitely committed to aid Britain. It warns the president, but suggests no alternative course of action under which he could carry out the duty which Congress has assigned to him of providing all-out effective aid to the British. The small group of isolationists in Congress have told the president what he should not do. This evening, the president gave the duly selected leaders of both parties in Congress the opportunity of telling him what they think he should do. In the course of human history, there are times when doing nothing may be more disastrous than doing something. There are times when a council of mere negation is not enough. The true leader is almost always the man of action. Speaker of the House Rayburn, after hearing the president read his speech, told him he approves it 100%. That's the first reaction to what the president will say to you tonight. Tonight's hour in history recalls other hours faced by other presidents when decision hung in the balance. American presidents are traditionally averse to war. No president has deliberately led this nation into war against the wishes of Congress and the people. But there are instances, beginning with the anxious days that preceded the War of 1812, when a war-minded America pushed a reluctant president into belligerence. That was true in 1812. And in the anxious weeks that preceded the Civil War, Abraham Lincoln prayed and hoped and struggled to avoid the steps that would bring war between the states. It was not the forces under his command that fired the first shots at Fort Sumter. For months, the peace-minded McKinley struggled against the jingles who demanded war against Spain, only to yield at the very moment when he had Spain's surrender in his hand. Many of you remember the abuse heaped upon the head of Woodrow Wilson, the scholar president who talked of peace without victory and sought to avoid war for the United States in a last great effort to bring about a fair and enduring peace in Europe. So when you listen to the president tonight, don't forget that he has taken counsel with many of our best minds. The great majority of our people has shown again and again that it trusts him, particularly in his conduct of our foreign affairs. The majority of our people has approved the policy of giving practical, effective help to Britain in the belief that this policy, at least, gave us a chance of avoiding total war. For in this, at least, the isolationists are right. The American people do not willfully want war. The division that is among us arises because we differ as to the best ways of keeping every kind of war away from the Western world, which we have vowed to protect against aggression. And that means aggression by secret propagandists, saboteurs, fifth columnists, trade stealers, and spies, as well as open military aggression. When your enemies are Nazis, you must define what is true peace and what is sneaking war. Feeling in Washington tonight is serious. The mood of the president is serious, as you will realize when he begins to speak. But the man who speaks tonight was chosen as the sovereign voice of the American people. He is your president and mine. Good night.
Stay tuned next for Lum and Abner.
The makers of Alka-Seltzer are proud to bring you those two lovable old radio friends of yours, Lum and Abner. You know, friends, as you listen to Lum and Abner on your radio, you realize that these friendly old characters always seem to find an amusing side to their troubles. But to most of us, our troubles are never amusing. For example, when we're troubled with such annoying ailments as acid indigestion, upset stomach, and heartburn, there's nothing funny about them. We often eat things that are not good for us. We sometimes eat too much, or we overindulge in other ways. And all these indiscretions tend to cause stomach distress. Ah, but there's a good answer to that, too. It's Alka-Seltzer, the friendly modern remedy so many turn to when they want quick relief. When one of these common ailments make life miserable for you, just do this. Drop one or two Alka-Seltzer tablets into a glass of water. Watch it bubble up and dissolve. Then drink this alkalizing solution. You'll feel better fast. Always remember, when you suffer with acid indigestion, distress after meals, or overindulgence, alkalize with Alka-Seltzer. Ask your druggist to serve you Alka-Seltzer at his soda fountain, and then get a package of these effervescent, alkalizing tablets to take home, ready to help you when you want pleasant relief for unpleasant ailments. And now, we take you to Pine Ridge. Well, now that Lum and Abner have opened the Jot 'em Down store, the old fellows are having difficulty replenishing their depleted stock of merchandise. As we look in on the little community today, we find them still arguing about straightening up the store.
Well, I swept out and washed the front windows, but I'll be dead blamed if I'm going to straighten up them shelves.
Wait a minute. Here comes a customer, Abner. Now, don't get to arguing while he's in here.
Oh, that ain't no customer. Just Cedric Weehunt.
Well, he might want to buy something. Come in, Cedric.
Howdy, Cedric.
Good morning. I just found out you fellas had opened up the store again.
Yeah, what can we do for you?
Well, I never wanted to buy nothing. I just wondered if I couldn't sell you some eggs.
No, we're selling, Cedric, not buying.
Well, wait a minute, Abner. We do need some eggs. Had a call for them this morning.
What are we going to use to buy them with, though?
Sit down, Cedric.
I don't reckon I've got time, Mr. Lum. If you fellas don't want these eggs, I better take them on over to Dick Huddleston's store.
Well, sit down. Don't get in such a rush. Maybe we can work up a trade here some kind.
Only kind of trading I do is for cash.
Might swap you some groceries, Cedric.
I don't need no groceries. See, I'm saving up cash so me and Clarabelle can get married.
Law me, are you and her still engaged, Cedric?
Yes, Mom, I reckon so.
Y'all been going to get married ever since she graduated from the 8th grade.
Well, I just can't get $100 saved up, though.
Well, you don't have to have no $100 to get married.
Well, that's what she says.
Well, I never had but $8 when me and Elizabeth got married.
Yeah, but look what you got.
Yeah. Huh?
You better be careful, Cedric. She might be marrying you for your money, you know.
Yeah, for $100, you ought to get somebody a heap better looking than she is, Cedric. Them buck teeth of her, and she could eat a watermelon through a picket fence.
Abner, I wouldn't say that. Beauty's only skin deep, you know.
Well, skin her then, Cedric.
For goodness sake, why don't you make up a new one once in a while?
Well, I believe I better be going.
Now, wait a minute, Cedric. We were just joshing here. Clarabelle's a right pretty girl.
Oh, my.
Sit down. How much of that $100 have you got saved up so far?
Well, I had $60, and then I bought these dad-blamed chickens and had to start all over. Just got $23 now.
Well, that's $60 and $23 you got now, Cedric. You ain't got fur to go.
Yes, Mom, but Clarabelle won't let me count the chickens, though. It's got to be all cash, she says.
Huh. Looks like everybody's needing cash.
I was just sitting here looking at you, Cedric. I believe you're a natural-born mercantile. How would you like to go in the store business?
Oh, I ain't got enough money to open up a store.
No, but you could buy interest in one mighty easy.
Yeah.
With $23?
Yes, sir. Me and Abner's needing a partner. Somebody with young ideas.
And eggs.
Yeah, or might even make a vice president out of you.
Oh, my, yeah, sure. Vice president in charge of sweeping out and doing the delivering.
Yeah, and straightening up the shelves.
Yeah.
Well, how much of interest would I get in the store, though?
$23.
Well, how much do I get paid back, though?
Well, that depends on how much profit the store makes.
No, Mom, I don't believe I'd be interested. Better keep it in cash. That's the way Clarabelle wants it.
Yeah, we could take that $23 and buy a lot of stuff we're needing.
If you're afraid of not getting your money back, Cedric, we could make you safe on your invest, all right.
Well, I'd have to know I could get it any time I wanted, I believe.
Let's see how we can do that.
Yeah, we'll guarantee it, Cedric.
I'll tell you what. We'll give you a $23 interest in the store and a $50 due bill.
Well, what's that?
Well, that means you can come in here and take $50 worth of groceries out of the store anytime you think the loan ain't good.
Yeah.
Well, I don't need no groceries, though.
No, but you could always sell that $50 due bill for something. Other folks that do need groceries, they'll buy it from you.
Why, sure they will.
All right, sir, it's a deal. Just make me out a due bill. Got the cash money right here.
Aye, grannies, that's the way to talk, Cedric.
Yes, sir.
Let me get a pencil and paper here.
Yeah. Get it on. Fix it up. Now, how about the eggs, Cedric? You ought to sell them to us on a credit now. You're a partner here in the store. You surely trust yourself.
Yes, Mama, oughtn't I?
Why, sure. Make a deal with yourself there.
Just a minute. Let me get busy here.
Recollect now, the cheaper you buy them for the store here, why, the more money you'll make for yourself.
Yes, Mama, I know. I'm talking to myself.
Well, excuse me for interrupting you.
I was aiming on getting 32 cents a dozen, but I believe I'll sell them to me for a quarter. And there's 4 dozen of them.
Well, that's a time. You're a good trader. I can see that already, Cedric. Beating yourself down on the price so quick that way. Just leave them sitting there. We'll sell them.
Yeah, Cedric. Due bill good for $50 in trade at the Jot 'em Down store. Signed, Lum Edwards. That's just as good as gold.
All right, there's your money.
Well.
$23, and it's all there, too. And I've got to go.
But you're going to work, too, in the store, ain't you, Cedric?
Yes, Mom, but I ain't starting till tomorrow morning.
Oh.
That's all right, Cedric. See you in the morning.
Yeah, yeah. Larry Doggy, that was a good deal, though.
Yeah, yeah. I hope we never take no advantage of him. I wouldn't cheat him for nothing.
Well, I reckon he went over to tell Clarabelle that he's a vice president now.
Yeah, well, he made a good deal. He can't lose nothing.
No.
Anytime he gets nervous about his invest, he can take that $50 worth of merchandise out of the store and sell it for enough to get his $23 back, you know.
Why, sure. And this'll give us a chance to buy some of the stuff we're needing, too. Potatoes and flour and one thing and another.
Yeah, I'll go into the wholesale house first thing in the morning and get a little of everything we need.
Yeah, that's the thing to do. Yeah, yeah.
Now, Granny, I'm a good mind to call up some of our old customers and tell them we're going to have a complete stock of merchandise now and we'd like to have them start trading with us again.
Well, instead of getting them old customers back, what we need to do is to get some new ones, Lum. We've had three old customers back already. All three of them brung in stuff they bought from us before we closed up a year ago. Wanted their money back on it.
Yeah, the Widder Abernathy stand there on the front porch whenever I come down to open up this morning. Had a sack of flour she bought over a year ago. Claimed it never made good biscuits and wanted me to take it back.
Where's it at?
Sitting right there.
My goodness.
I never give her the money back. I traded her some canned goods for it. She couldn't make biscuits with the best flour in the world.
Well, wait, that ain't our flour, Lum. We never carried that brand in our life. Dick Huddleston sells that, Lum.
My grannies, that's right. Well, what do you know about that? That's a gooder known hurry. Carrying that stuff back to the wrong store. Wait a minute here.
What's the matter?
Nothing.
Well, looks to me like she skinned you out of some groceries, Lum.
Them's the things we got to stop in this store. Small leaks sink great ships.
Leaks.
That's where our profits is going. First thing you know, our ship will be sunk.
What in the world are you talking about?
The store here.
The store's a boat?
In a way, yes.
For goodness sakes, if it was, it couldn't sink sitting up here on dry ground no way long.
I mean, there's leaks in the store, and we've got to watch them or we're goners.
Oh, yeah. Ain't but one, though. Back there in the feed room, we all have set a tub under it when it's raining.
Well, there's leaks in this store when it ain't raining, too.
You mean to sit there and say there's water coming through the roof right now?
Not water, profits I'm talking about. Money.
Money coming through the roof and you're complaining?
No, it's going out.
Oh, well, we better set the tub up on top of the roof then, Lum.
Abner, for goodness sakes, all I
said...
Oh,
wait a minute, Lum. It's all rain sure the world.
Well, good. Saved by the bell. I'll answer it.
I weren't going to answer it. Wouldn't waste my time on a telephone if it's raining money around here.
Hello, jot them down, store. Lum Eddard's doing the talking.
Get up there on the roof. That's where
Who?
I'm going.
Oh, how are you, Miss Bates?
Stand there and reach out. Grab a
yes,
ten,
Ma.
$10
Just
bill.
Opened up yesterday.
Get a whole tub full of money.
You want to do what?
No.
Yes, Mom, get a pencil and paper, Abner, and take down this order.
Oh,
Miss Bates wanting to buy $50 worth of groceries.
Well, good for her. Good for us.
What's that? You've got a what? Oh. Why, just a minute. Now we're into it.
Huh?
You know what that Cedric done?
I got a pretty good idea.
Taking that $50 due bill over and sold it to Miss Bates for $35. Now she wants the groceries.
Well, I'll be dead blamed. $50 worth of groceries for $23. If that don't beat the bugs a-fightin'.
Well, Lum and Abner have a pretty big job ahead of them in building up their jot-em-down store again. But in these days, most of us have plenty of work to look forward to. And so here's a friendly warning to all of you listeners who have work to do. Don't take any chances with that job of yours. Don't lose a day's pay. Don't allow a headache or an upset stomach or some other similar common ailment to keep you from putting in a full day's work or keep you home off the job. Now, of course, if you're really sick, the thing to do is to see your family doctor. But for those common everyday ailments such as headaches, upset stomach, acid indigestion, muscular fatigue, and morning after misery, just remember that the thing to do for prompt relief and pleasant relief is to drink a sparkling glass of Alka-Seltzer. When you take Alka-Seltzer for these common troublemakers, you help yourself to real relief. The analgesic in Alka-Seltzer offers quick relief for headaches and muscular aches and pains. And the alkalizer promptly eases the distress of upset stomach due to acid indigestion and that morning after misery. So be wise. Ask your druggist for Alka-Seltzer tonight or tomorrow. Why not get two packages? Then you can keep one at home and the other at the place where you work. You can never tell when you're going to need the prompt relief and the pleasant relief that Alka-Seltzer offers. Be sure to listen to Lum and Abner Thursday night. Now, that's day after tomorrow at this same time. Lum and Abner are now on the air every Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, and Friday evening at 7:15 p.m. over this station. Lou Crosby speaking. See you Thursday. This is the National Broadcasting Company.
Stay tuned next for Fibber, McGee, and Molly.
The Johnson Wax Program with Fibber, McGee, and Molly. The makers of Johnson's Wax and Johnson's Self-Polishing Glow Coat present Fibber, McGee, and Molly, written by Don Quinn, with music by the King's Men and Billy Mills Orchestra. The show opens with So Sweet. When you buy linoleum, its colors are bright and fresh. Wouldn't it be nice if you could always keep them that way? Well, you can very easily, simply by buying a can of Johnson's Self-Polishing Glow Coat. Glow Coat will not only keep the colors bright and new-looking, but it will also make the linoleum last years longer than floor covering that is continually scrubbed with soap and water. Too much scrubbing softens and cracks the surface. Glow Coat protects the surface. And besides this protection, Glow Coat is a wonderful labor saver. In the first place, it requires no rubbing or buffing. It's self-polishing. Just apply and let dry, and in 20 minutes you have a sparkling, beautiful floor. In the second place, it's easy to keep a glow-coated floor spotless. Spots and stains wipe up quickly with a damp cloth. You can use Glow Coat on your other floors, too, painted and varnished wood, rubber, and asphalt tile. You'll find it everywhere, that attractive red and yellow can of Johnson's Self-Polishing Glow Coat. What is so rare as a day in spring in Wistful Vista, with Mrs. McGee sitting reading on the porch, her husband picking weeds out of the lawn, and his on and off pal Gildersleeve fixing window screens next door? We can't think of anything. But that's how it is today with Fibber, McGee, and Molly.
Hey, Molly. I got an notion to go fishing. I just found a worm.
Well, keep scratching around, dear. Maybe you'll find a horseshoe and we can go horseback riding.
Hey, how many dandelion greens you got to have to make dandelion wine?
The way you're working, McGee, you won't have enough by September to get a cucaracha cockeyed.
You pipe down, Gildersleeve. I was talking to my wife.
Well, I thought I'd take over your conversation for a while. You must get pretty tired of it.
Say, aren't you men going to play tennis this afternoon? Or is it too strenuous for you athletes?
Oh, Gildersleeve says he had to fix the window screens. I don't know why. I've seen all his clothes, and if I was a moth, I wouldn't want them.
You tell her the real reason, McGee. You got smart and started bouncing the ball that landed on the roof.
Well, get it down again. Heavenly days, I'll even buy you a new one.
Huh? You will?
Yes, I will. Anything to keep you too quiet. I'm trying to read this article about us in Liberty Magazine.
Oh, you mean in the May 27th issue? Well, I can take a hint even if Gildersleeve can't. Hey, Gildy, come down off of that ladder a minute. I want to get my tennis ball off the roof.
Who are you giving orders to, you little cigar holder? Get a ladder of your own.
Well, of all the nerve. Get a ladder of your own, he says. That's my ladder you're on, and you know it, Gildersleeve. You borrowed it 3 weeks ago.
You mean I managed to get it back 3 weeks ago?
Why, you big salami. You know very well you just took it to fix that smoking chimney last April.
Yes, and you borrowed it in January to get your alarm clock out of the elm tree.
My heavens, what was our clock doing in the tree?
I threw it at a cat one night. Now look, Gildersleeve, I was the original owner of that ladder, as you very darn well know. And I've been pretty good-natured about you using it. Now get off, I want it back.
You got as much chance of getting it back as I have of bailing out over Scotland. And get away from this ladder. You make me nervous.
McGee, don't shake that ladder. You'll make him fall.
Oh, so what? Might jar a little sense into him. Yeah. You going to get down off of that ladder, Gildersleeve, or do I have to shake you off like a rotten apple?
I won't get down. By George, this is my ladder, and I have a right... Stop it! Stop it! Mrs. McGee, make him stop teasing me.
Oh, quit running to Mama, you big squealer. And I'll give you till I count 10 to get off of that ladder.
Go on, you can't count up to 10. You stop shaking that ladder! Stop it!
McGee, be careful. He might fall on you and hurt you.
I can dodge him. That big blimp is so slow he can't even fall fast. Well, you coming down, Gildersleeve?
No, I'm not. And when I lay hands on you, you miserable little monkey, I'll...
Okay, you asked for it.
What? Oh, don't stop it! Stop it! No!
Pushed a little too hard.
Oh. Heavenly days. Is he hurt, McGee?
Of course he ain't hurt. He bounced 8 feet. The big bladder.
Oh. Well, I'm ashamed of you, both. Now you come right in the house before you have any more trouble.
Oh, Molly, I don't want to go in the house.
Wait till I get hold of you.
What you want me to go in the house for, Molly? You want to talk something over? Okay, let's go.
Oh, wait a minute, McGee. I've got something I want to talk to you.
What you want to talk about, Molly?
McGee, I'm ashamed of you, fighting and arguing in front of all the neighbors.
Oh, they love it.
But you had no right to push that ladder over with Mr. Gildersleeve on it.
Why, shucks, it's no fun pushing over an empty ladder. Besides, I didn't mean to push it so hard.
But you were wrong in the first place. It is his ladder.
Why, Molly, how can you stand there with your neck sticking through that string of seashells I bought you one Christmas long before we were married and say such a thing like that? It is, too, my ladder.
Oh, no, it isn't.
Dad ratted, it is, too. I distinctly remember tearing the wrappings off of it the day it come from the hardware store. Don't you remember that?
Yes, I do.
Aha. Uh-huh.
Because you borrowed it from Mr. Gildersleeve before it was even off the truck.
What? I did? Oh, sure.
Even though you've always claimed Mr. Gildersleeve was a pushover, you didn't have to prove it.
Well, gee whiz, I didn't mean to push it so hard.
Nevertheless, I want you to march right outside and offer your apologies.
Oh, okay, okay. Come on. Hey, Gildersleeve, I want to talk to you a minute.
Oh, that's fine, little chum. That's fine. I want to talk to you, too.
That's swell. About that little ladder episode, Throcky. I had...
Look out, McGee. He's got a baseball bat behind his back.
Come on back here,
assassin, and I'll wham a little of the whimsy out of your skippy little skull.
Now, just a minute, Mr. Gildersleeve. All McGee wanted was to tell
you to... tell him, Molly. It's all off. Yep. If you want me so bad, Gildersleeve, come on up here and get me.
All right, by George, I will.
One step further and I sue you for trespass.
You come on down here on city property and see what happens. You feeble little fugitive from a flit gun.
Why, you overinflated blimp. If I ever came down there, I'd slap you so flat you could go to the hospital by mail.
Look, McGee, you'll never get together with him this way.
Well, what'll I do?
Go inside and call him up.
You think he'll let me talk?
Well, it's worth trying. Come on in.
Okay.
Oh, running away, eh?
Oh, go smoke some corn silk, you adolescent apple knocker. Come on.
Why, George, if he ever came within reach of me,
give me the telephone.
Here, I'll watch out the window and see if his wife calls him in.
Okay. Hello, operator. Give me the residence of Throckport and Pete Goodfoot. Huh? Oh, is that you, Mert?
Oh, dear, oh, dear.
How's every little thing, Mert? It is, eh? What's that, Mert? Your baby sister. Oh, got two new teeth this morning.
Ah, oh, how sweet. How old is the little type, dearie?
19. Had some teeth kicked out Saturday night in the jitterbug contest. What's that, Mert? Oh, okay. Thanks, Mert. No answer, Mert.
Well, you've simply got to apologize. Send him a telegram.
Say, now you're using glow coat. That's a great idea. I'll fix it to... Oh, no, that ain't a good idea either.
Well, why isn't it?
Well, he'd just fly into another rage when he saw the telegram was collect. If there was only some way I could make him listen to me without knowing what... Hot dog! I got it!
You have?
Yeah. Now get this, folks. It's the crux of the whole program.
Oh, what is it?
Look, let's say I go down to the Wistful Vista Recording Studios and make a phonograph record of a handsome apology and send it to Gildersleeve. He'd play it out of curiosity, and it'd be over before he knew what it was all about.
Say, that's a wonderful idea. Get your hat and we'll...
Oh, is that Gildersleeve?
Let me peek. No, it isn't. It's Mrs. Uppington.
Oh, swell. Oh, watch me insult her, too, so I can make an extra record.
Now, McGee, please don't do that. We've got trouble enough.
Oh, it's all in fun, Molly. Come in.
Don't do it, McGee. She's too dumb to realize what... Oh, how do you do, Mrs. Uppington?
How do you do, Mrs. McGee? And Mr. McGee? My goodness, what is wrong with Mr. Gildersleeve? I just met him outside.
Well, he's angry with my husband, Abigail. McGee knocked him off a ladder.
Good heavens. What on earth caused you to do that, Mr. McGee?
Oh, just the impulse, Uppy. I get them now and then. For instance, I never see you riding along in that limousine of yours, sitting there simpering like a dummy in a showcase without wanting to heave a rock right through the window.
Oh, here. McGee, I told you...
Well, really, Mr. McGee, I find your sense of humor in very bad taste, if I may say so.
You may say so, Ab.
Mr. McGee, your sense of humor is in very bad taste.
Ah, don't be a guppy, Uppy. You couldn't take a joke if it was tattooed...
McGee! You stop it this minute. He's just trying to insult you, Abigail. Don't pay any attention to him.
But I don't understand, Mrs. McGee. Why should he wish to insult me?
Well, he wants to make another record.
What, another one?
What do you mean, another one?
Why, you already hold the record for being the most boorish, insignificant, maladjusted little malamute in the neighborhood, if I may say so.
You may.
I do.
You did.
I know. Goodbye.
Well, you asked for it, dearie.
Yes, I know. Ah, the old moose tosses a pretty sassy adjective, don't she? Hey, is Gildersleeve still out in front any place?
Let me take a look. No, no, I don't see... Wait a minute.
Huh?
What's that sticking out from behind that tree?
Let me see. That's Gildersleeve's stomach. He thinks he's hiding. Like trying to hide a horse in a handbag. Well, let him wait. Come on, we'll sneak out the back way and go out the back door and hurry down the...
Welcome to the Wistful Vista Recording Studios, my friends. Is this your first visit?
Yes, it is, Mr.
Tate. Asa M. Tate. And if I do say so myself, an Asa Tate record is the best record made.
Bud. My name is Fibber McGee.
Not the Fibber McGee.
What do you mean, the Fibber McGee?
The Fibber McGee who came in just now to make a recording.
Yes, that's me, Toot.
Tate.
Tate?
Yes, as in Tate Funny McGee.
Oh.
Now, what can we do for you?
Well, you see, Mr. Taint, McGee insulted a man next door. And we want to send him a recording of an apology.
I see, I see. A splendid idea. We can handle that just as soon as we have a free studio.
Oh, you're pretty busy here?
Oh, thriving, Mrs. McGee, thriving. This idea has taken hold like a lady wrestler on a masher. Everyone is recording. Valentines, love messages, speeches, legal documents.
What do you mean, legal documents?
Oh, yes. The human voice is accepted in court just like a signature.
Is that so?
Yes. For instance, there's a gentleman in Studio C who is making a recording of his last will and testament. Step this way and we'll peep in for a moment. Now, be very quiet.
And to the rest of my heirs and assigns, I bequeath the residue of my estate, including house and furniture and all things appertaining thereto, with the proviso that during their lives they shall protect all wood and enamel surfaces against dampness, dirt, and wear with Johnson's wax. The finest protective polish that...
Wilcox!
Oh, dear me. You broke right into the middle of the recording.
Oh, shucks, I'm sorry.
Hello there, folks.
Oh, why the record, Mr. Wilcox?
Well, it's logical, Molly. This is my will I'm recording.
Yeah, we know, but why?
Look, you put wax on your most important things, don't you?
Yes.
So why shouldn't you put your most important things on wax?
There's another similarity, too, Howard.
What's that?
You ought to have it on a record because you've been going round and round on the same subject for 6 years.
I hope you'll excuse the interruption, Mr. Wilcox. I didn't know these were friends of yours.
Well, I'm not so sure now.
Oh, now, Mr. Wilcox, you know very well that we...
And be it hereby expressly devised that in the course of protecting and beautifying said household appurtenances, Johnson's wax is positively the most dependable, durable, labor-saving protection for wood, leather, and enamel surfaces...
Come on, Molly.
...that ever...
Isn't Mr. Wilcox very young to be making out his will, dearie?
Oh, not necessarily. He knows he's going to kill himself one of these days trying to think up new ways to say the same old thing. Oh, dear, we throw him in there anyway. Look, Bud, how soon can I make my recording?
Now, don't be impatient, Mr. McGee. We're very, very busy, you know. Let me think now.
Well, hello there, Johnny. Hello, daughter.
Oh, hello there, Mr. Oldtimer. What are you doing here?
Well, do you two know this gentleman, too?
Oh, sure. He's our oldest friend. Aren't you, Oldtimer?
If you can think of one that's older, bring him around, Johnny, and I'll razzle him for 50 cents.
What did you say you were doing here?
Who, me? Oh, we just finished recording some hot jive, daughter. Me and my band.
Your band? You got a band?
Yep, small combo, Johnny. Hot and sweet. Call him the old-timer and he's a sexagenarian. Ain't a one of us under 16, we make Goodman and them Dorsey kids sound like hand organs in a hailstorm.
Well, heavenly days, imagine that. Are you making anything out of it, or do you work like George Bernard Shaw for your room and beard?
That's pretty good, daughter, but that ain't the way I heard it. The way I... Uh-oh. Say, you gotta excuse me, kids. Gotta run down the hall and get some refills.
Refills for what?
My comb. That's what I play in the band. Comb and tissue paper. Well, see you later, kids. I'll send you one of my records.
Well, this isn't getting us anyplace, Bud. I want to get busy. Haven't you got a studio we can use?
Of course, of course. You can use Studio E just as soon as the King's men get through recording their version of Open Your Heart and Say Ah. Right in here, please.
Oh, where's it going to get you with love playing hard to get? Where's it going to get you with me? Where's it going to get you with anyone?
You'll be sorry. You'll never get no place of shaking your head. Nowhere, no sir, so instead, here's a formula for shaking the lead. Open your heart and say, ah, you gotta be sweet if you wanna be wise. Sugar, honey, treatment that'll open your eyes, open your heart and say, ah. If I pet you when the lights are low, what's it gonna get you if you answer no? What are you gonna use for memories? If you're not open-minded, what'll you know? You're gonna get kisses, you're gonna get love, more than your share, baby, of. What you're hoping if you'll open your heart? Open wide, so I can hear it say it, ah. Won't get diamonds, not like that. If I'm the doctor when I call at your flat, open your heart and say, ah. If I take you strolling by the bay, I may have to make you see the light of day. Gotta get what I get from you gladly. So get your heart to beating, what do you say? You're gonna get kisses, you're gonna get love, more than you've been dreaming of. So now you better start to open your heart. Open wide, so I can hear it saying, ah, ah. Mind the doctor, open up your heart and say,
Booth is waving at you again.
Oh, how am I doing, Mr. Tate?
Very, very good, Mr. McGee. The first part we brought in very well, but for this next part, get into the microphone a little more.
Oh.
Yeah, that's it. And it will help if you take the cigar out of your mouth. Thank you.
It's about time you ditched that stogie, McGee. I didn't know whether you were recording an apology or smoke gets in your eyes.
Well, you ready to cut the rest of it, bud?
All ready, Mr. McGee. Start talking when the bell rings. Ready?
Ready. And that's why I want you to know, guilty old man, that I am sorry I pushed you off of the ladder. I hope we can be friends again from now on, and in honor of the occasion, here is a little poem I wrote. The world would be a better place to live in if guys like I would admit they're wrong and give in without their wife forcing them almost to do it. But I know if I hadn't did it, I would rue it. So here's to you, a friend true blue, from your little chum next door, dear Throcky. To have you as a pal, I consider myself pretty lucky. There. How was it, Molly?
Fine, dearie. All but that poem.
Well, maybe it could have been polished up a little bit, but it's the sentiment that counts.
Sentiment.
I says sentiment.
I know, and I said sediment.
Oh.
That's what's left after the drip has stopped.
Well, I'm afraid you just don't appreciate the finer
well,
things.
Everything is splendid, Mr. McGee, splendid.
Oh, fine.
And I hope you can use our services again sometime.
Thank you, Mr. Tate.
You got the address where to send that record, didn't you, Bud?
Oh, yes, Mr. McGee. Mr. Throckmorton P. Gildersleeve, 83 Wistful Vista.
Yes, and send this note with it.
It'll be on its way in half an hour. A good day.
Good day, Mr. Tate.
So long, Tate.
Well, frankly now, McGee, don't you feel better for having made that apology? Even if Mr. Gildersleeve hasn't seen it yet.
Oh, yes, I guess I do, but...
Hello, Mr. McGee. Hello, Mrs. McGee.
Oh, hi, Wimple.
My, my, you're looking happy and cheerful for a change, Mr. Wimple.
Oh, I am. I'm just a different person when I come down here to make my records. It cheers me up no end.
What kind of records you make, Wimple? You a singer?
Oh, no. I just talk.
Oh, recitations, huh?
In a way, yes. You see, I record the things I would like to say to my wife. I spend the first half hour working myself into a rage. And then I make a recording of giving her the most terrible bawling out. Then I sit here and play it to myself over and over and over.
This sure gets it out of your system, doesn't it, Wimple? Ever think what would happen if she ever got hold of one of those records?
Oh, yes, I have. I wake up nights in a cold sweat about it. But it's worth all the risk, Mr. McGee.
Look, Mr. Wimple, why don't you brace up and really send her one of the records? It would show her that you really have a little spirit.
Mrs. McGee, would not only show her that I have one, but 5 minutes after she heard it, I'd be one.
Well, come on, Molly. Let's hurry home and wait for Gildersleeve's reaction.
All right.
Hey, he ought to be coming over any minute now, Molly. I just seen a motorcycle messenger deliver a package.
Well, that's fine, dearie. I'll be so glad when this is straightened out, all this senseless bickering and quarreling. Anybody'd think you hated each other.
We do, down underneath. But on the surface, there never was two finer friends. Why, when I think of all...
Heavenly days, what on earth is that?
There you are, you little Weisenheimer.
What?
You practical joker, you custard pie comedian.
Huh?
Send me a smart aleck phonograph record and a sarcastic note, will you? By George.
No. Now, wait a minute. What's the matter? What do you mean a sarcastic note?
Well, listen to this.
Huh?
Dear Throcky, forget what happened this afternoon and play this record.
Yes?
As a little token of my esteem. Well. Then you'll know what I really think of you. Signed, your little chum, Fibber.
Well, I don't see anything wrong with that. Didn't you play the record, Mr. Gildersleeve?
Yes, I did. Well. And I want to tell you right now, McGee, if you were worth spoiling a good 10-cent shine on, I'd knock you down and kick your ears off.
Oh, my.
As it is, I'll just break this record over your dilly little dough.
Oh, Mr. Gildersleeve.
Hey, what's the idea?
And never speak to me again, you crumbwit.
Well, I'll be... What's the matter with that guy? Ain't he got any sense of justice?
Oh, dear.
I put my whole heart and soul into that record.
Sure you did. Maybe it was that poem that got him, though I don't quite... Oh, heavenly days, look. Look at the label.
Huh?
They sent him the wrong record.
What?
This is the one that the old-timer was sending to us.
Huh?
Well, no wonder Mr. Gildersleeve got mad.
Well, what do you mean?
Look at the title. I'll be glad when you're dead, you rascal, you.
Oh,
Fibber and Molly will be back in just a moment. Say, aren't these just about the busiest days you could imagine? There's so many things to do every hour of the day, it almost seems like the days are getting shorter instead of longer. Of course, that makes us all grateful for anything that saves us time and work. That is, unnecessary work. Which brings me, naturally, to Johnson's self-polishing glow coat. The modern floor polish that goes on saving hours of work every day for women everywhere. The main point about glow coat is that it not only saves work, it makes floors more beautiful, protects them against wear, keeps the colors of linoleum fresh and bright indefinitely. In fact, makes your whole kitchen a more cheerful place to work in. It's because glow coat has so many advantages at such small cost that its popularity just goes on increasing month after month. Glow coat needs no rubbing or buffing, remember that. You just apply and let dry. In 20 minutes, you have a floor that sparkles with beauty. Need I say more? Order Johnson's self-polishing glow coat tomorrow.
Well, it's really too bad the records got mixed up, dearie.
Yeah.
But you can have the man at the recording studio send Mr. Gildersleeve an explanation.
Yeah, I can straighten that out, okay. I'd even kind of like to go down and make some more records.
All right, let's. You have a dandy voice for it.
Honest, you think so?
I certainly do. You might even get a job as a news commentator.
Oh, boy.
Like Raymond Graham Jazz.
Swing.
Well, you could try that too, but commentating is more dignified.
Good night.
Good night, all.
This is Harlow Wilcox, speaking for the makers of Johnson's Wax Finishes for the home and for industry, inviting you to be with us again next Tuesday night. Good night.
Folks, I'm the cop down here on the corner of 14th and Oak Streets. You know, where all the traffic swings east. I've been noticing lately that so many of the cars are all polished up fit to kill. So I stops one of them today and asks how come. Well, officer, he says, it seems like all the buys have suddenly discovered a new auto polish that does a double job. Cleans and wax polishes in one application. It's a cinch now. Don't the old bus shine? Sure does, says I. And what is the name of this new auto polish? Johnson's Carnu, says he. C-A-R-N-U. Made by the makers of Johnson's Wax.
This is the National Broadcasting Company.
Stay tuned next for the President of the United States.
Good evening from the White House in Washington. the chief executive and Mrs. Roosevelt are host tonight to a very distinguished gathering of ambassadors, ministers, and chargé d'affaires from our neighbor countries of the Western Hemisphere and some of our country's leading statesmen and their families. Mr. Roosevelt was to have been guest of these same diplomats at the Pan-American Union 2 weeks ago, but that event was canceled due to his indisposition. At that time, the world was warned not to expect an utterance of extreme importance, but that warning has not been repeated as to this talk. Following on the heels of important world developments, the president has been busy for several days writing and rewriting his talk to conform with rapidly changing conditions abroad, conditions which may directly affect the Americas. The flags of the United States, the president, and the 21 American republics have been arranged as a backdrop for the chief executive as he sits at his special broadcasting desk in the brilliantly lighted East Room facing all microphones and the cameras of the newsreels. With a Latin American diplomat seated before him, the chief executive speaks, the world listens. Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States.
My fellow Americans of all the Americas, my friends, I am speaking tonight from the White House in the presence of the governing board of the Pan-American Union, the Canadian minister, and their families. The members of this board are the ambassadors and ministers of the American republics in Washington. It is appropriate that I do this, for now as never before, the unity of the American republics is of supreme importance to each and every one of us and to the cause of freedom throughout the world. Our future independence is bound up with the future independence of all of our sister republics. The pressing problems that confront us are military and naval problems. We cannot afford to approach them from the point of view of wishful thinkers or sentimentalists. What we face is cold, hard facts. The first and fundamental fact is that what started as a European war has developed, as the Nazis always intended it should develop, into a war for world domination. Adolf Hitler never considered the domination of Europe as an end in itself. European conquest was but a step toward ultimate goals in all the other continents. It is unmistakably apparent to all of us that unless the advance of Hitlerism is forcibly checked now, the Western Hemisphere will be within range of the Nazi weapons of destruction. For our own defense, we have accordingly undertaken certain obvious, necessary measures. First, we have joined in concluding a series of agreements with all the other American republics. This further solidified our hemisphere against the common danger. And then, a year ago, we launched and are successfully carrying out the largest armament production program we have ever undertaken. We have added substantially to our splendid Navy, and we have mustered our manpower to build up a new army, which is already worthy of the highest traditions of our military service. We instituted a policy of aid for the democracies, the nations which have fought for the continuation of human liberties. This policy had its origin in the first month of the war, when I urged upon the Congress repeal of the arms embargo provisions in the old neutrality law. And in that message of September 1939, I said, I should like to be able to offer the hope that the shadow over the world might swiftly pass. I cannot. The facts compel my stating with candor that darker periods may lie ahead. In the subsequent months, the shadows did deepen and lengthen, and the night spread over Poland, Denmark, Norway, Holland, Belgium, Luxembourg, and France. In June 1940, Britain stood alone, faced by the same machine of terror, which had overwhelmed her allies. Our government rushed arms to meet her desperate needs. In September 1940, an agreement was completed with Great Britain for the trade of 50 destroyers for 8 important offshore bases. And in March 1941, this year, the Congress passed the Lend-Lease Bill and an appropriation of $7 billion to implement it. This law realistically provided for material aid for the government of any country whose defense the President deems vital to the defense of the United States. Our whole program of aid for the democracies has been based on hard-headed concern for our own security and for the kind of safe and civilized world in which we wish to live. Every dollar of material that we send helps to keep the dictators away from our own hemisphere, and every day that they are held off gives us time to build more guns and tanks and planes and ships. We have made no pretense about our own self-interest in this aid. Great Britain understands it, and so does Nazi Germany. And now, after a year, Britain still fights gallantly on a far-flung battle line. We have doubled and redoubled our vast production, increasing month by month our material supply of the tools of war for ourselves and for Britain and for China, and eventually for all the democracies. The supply of these tools will not fail. It will increase. With greatly augmented strength, the United States and the other American republics now chart their course in the situation of today. Your government knows what terms Hitler, if victorious, would impose. They are indeed the only terms on which he would accept a so-called negotiated peace. And under those terms, Germany would literally parcel out the world, hoisting the swastika itself over vast territories and populations, and setting up puppet governments of its own choosing, wholly subject to the will and the policy of a conqueror. To the people of the Americas, a triumphant Hitler would say, as he said after the seizure of Austria, and as he said after Munich, and as he said after the seizure of Czechoslovakia, I am now completely satisfied. This is the last territorial readjustment I will seek. And he would, of course, add, all we want is peace and friendship and profitable trade relations with you in the New World. Were any of us in the Americas so incredibly simple and forgetful as to accept those honeyed words, what would then happen? Those in the New World who were seeking profits would be urging that all that the dictatorships desired was peace. They would oppose toil and taxes for more American armament. And meanwhile, the dictatorships would be forcing the enslaved peoples of their old world conquests into a system they are even now organizing to build a naval and air force intended to gain and hold and be master of the Atlantic and the Pacific as well. They would fasten an economic stranglehold upon our several nations. Quislings would be found to subvert the governments in our republics, and the Nazis would back their fifth columns with invasion if necessary. No, I am not speculating about all this. I merely repeat what is already in the Nazi Book of World Conquest. They plan to treat the Latin American nations as they are now treating the Balkans. They planned then to strangle the United States of America and the Dominion of Canada. The American laborer would have to compete with slave labor in the rest of the world. Minimum wages, maximum hours, nonsense. Wages and hours fixed by Hitler. The dignity and power and standard of living of the American worker and farmer would be gone. Trade unions would become historic relics and collective bargaining a joke. Farm income? What happens to all farm surpluses without any foreign trade? The American farmer would get for his products exactly what Hitler wanted to give. And the farmer would face obvious disaster and complete regimentation. Tariff walls, Chinese walls of isolation would be futile. Freedom to trade is essential to our economic life. We do not eat all the food we produce. We do not burn all the oil we can pump. We do not use all the goods we can manufacture. It would not be an American wall to keep Nazi goods out. It would be a Nazi wall to keep us in. The whole fabric of working life as we know it, business and manufacturing, mining and agriculture, all would be mangled and crippled under such a system. Yet to maintain even that crippled independence would require permanent conscription of our manpower. It would curtail the funds we could spend on education, on housing, on public works, on flood control, on health. And instead, we should be permanently pouring our resources into armaments. And year in and year out, standing day and night watch against the destruction of our cities. Yes, even our right of worship would be threatened. The Nazi world does not recognize any god except Hitler. For the Nazis are as ruthless as the communists in the denial of God. What place has religion, which preaches the dignity of the human being, the majesty of the human soul, in a world where moral standards are measured by treachery and bribery and fifth columnism? Will our children, too, wander off, goose-stepping in search of new gods? We do not accept, we will not permit this Nazi shape of things to come. It will never be forced upon us if we act in this present crisis with the wisdom and the courage which have distinguished our country in all the crises of the past. Today, the Nazis have taken military possession of the greater part of Europe. In Africa, they have occupied Tripoli and Libya, and they are threatening Egypt, the Suez Canal, and the Near East. But their plans do not stop there, for the Indian Ocean is the gateway to the Farther East. They also have the armed power at any moment to occupy Spain and Portugal. And that threat extends not only to French North Africa and the western end of the Mediterranean Sea, it extends also to the Atlantic fortress of Dakar, and to the island outposts of the New World, the Azores and Cape Verde Islands. Yes, these Cape Verde Islands are only 7 hours distance from Brazil by bomber or troop-carrying planes. They dominate shipping routes to and from the South Atlantic. The war is approaching the brink of the Western Hemisphere itself. It is coming very close to home. Control or occupation by Nazi forces of any of the islands of the Atlantic would jeopardize the immediate safety of portions of North and South America and of the island possessions of the United States, and therefore of the ultimate safety of the continental United States itself. Hitler's plan of world domination would be near its accomplishment today were it not for two factors. One is the epic resistance of Britain, her colonies, and the great dominions, fighting not only to maintain the existence of the island of Britain, but also to hold the Near East and Africa. The other is the magnificent defense of China, which will, I have reason to believe, increase in strength. And all of these together are preventing the Axis from winning control of the seas by ships and aircraft. The Axis powers can never achieve their objective of world domination unless they first obtain control of the seas. That is their supreme purpose today. And to achieve it, they must capture Great Britain. They could then have the power to dictate to the Western Hemisphere. No spurious argument, no appeal to sentiment, no false pledges like those given by Hitler at Munich can deceive the American people into believing that he and his Axis partners would not, with Britain defeated, close in relentlessly on this hemisphere of ours. But if the Axis powers fail to gain control of the seas, then they are certainly defeated. Their dreams of world domination will then go by the board, and the criminal leaders who started this war will suffer inevitable disaster. Both they and their people know this, and they and their people are afraid. That is why they are risking everything they have, conducting desperate attempts to break through to the command of the ocean. Once they are limited to a continuing land war, their cruel forces of occupation will be unable to keep their heel on the necks of the millions of innocent, oppressed peoples on the continent of Europe. And in the end, their whole structure will break into little pieces. And let us remember that the wider the Nazi land effort, the greater is their ultimate danger. We do not forget the silenced people. Masters of Germany, those at least who have not been assassinated or escaped to free soil, have marked these silenced peoples and their children's children for slavery. But those people, spiritually unconquered, Austrians, Czechs, Poles, Norwegians, Dutch, Belgians, Frenchmen, Greeks, Southern Slavs, yes, even those Italians and Germans who themselves have been enslaved, will prove to be a powerful force in the final disruption of the Nazi system. All freedom, meaning freedom to live and not freedom to conquer and subjugate other peoples, depends on freedom of the seas. All of American history, North, Central, and South American history, has been inevitably tied up with those words, freedom of the seas. Since 1799, 142 years ago, when our infant navy made the West Indies and the Caribbean and the Gulf of Mexico safe for American ships, since 1804 and 1805, when we made all peaceful commerce safe from the depredations of the Barbary pirates, since the War of 1812, which was fought for the preservation of sailors' rights, since 1867, when our sea power made it possible for the Mexicans to expel the French army of Louis Napoleon. We have striven and fought in defense of freedom of the seas. Freedom of the seas for our own shipping, for the commerce of our sister republics, for the right of all nations to use the highways of world trade, and for our own safety. During the First World War, we were able to escort merchant ships by the use of small cruisers and gunboats and destroyers. And that type, called convoy, was effective against submarines. In this Second World War, however, the problem is greater. It is different, because the attack on the freedom of the seas is now fourfold. First, the improved submarine. Second, the much greater use of the heavily armed raiding cruiser or the hit-and-run battleship. Third, the bombing airplane, which is capable of destroying merchant ships 700 or 800 miles from its nearest base. And fourth, the destruction of merchant ships in those ports of the world that are accessible to bombing attack. The Battle of the Atlantic now extends from the icy waters of the North Pole to the frozen continent of the Antarctic. Throughout this huge area, there have been sinkings of merchant ships in alarming and increasing numbers by Nazi raiders or submarines. There have been sinkings even of ships carrying neutral flags. There have been sinkings in the South Atlantic, off West Africa, and the Cape Verde Islands, between the Azores and the islands off the American coast, and between Greenland and Iceland. Great numbers of these sinkings have been actually within the waters of the Western Hemisphere itself. The blunt truth of this seems to be this, and I reveal this with the full knowledge of the British government. The present rate of Nazi sinkings of merchant ships is more than three times as high as the capacity of British shipyards to replace them. It is more than twice the combined British and American output of merchant ships today. We can answer this peril by two simultaneous measures. First, by speeding up and increasing our own great shipbuilding program, and second, by helping to cut down the losses on the high seas. Attacks on shipping off the very shores of land which we are determined to protect present an actual military danger to the Americas. And that danger has recently been heavily underlined by the presence in Western Hemisphere waters of a Nazi battleship of great striking power. You remember that most of the supplies for Britain go by a northerly route, which comes close to Greenland and the nearby island of Iceland. Germany's heaviest attack is on that route. Nazi occupation of Iceland or bases in Greenland would bring the war close to our own continental shores, because those places are stepping stones to Labrador, to Newfoundland, to Nova Scotia, yes, to the northern United States itself, including the great industrial centers of the North, the East, and the Middle West. Equally, the Azores and the Cape Verde Islands, if occupied or controlled by Germany, would directly endanger the freedom of the Atlantic and our own American physical safety. Under German domination, those islands would become bases for submarines, warships, and airplanes, raiding the waters that lie immediately off our own coasts and attacking the shipping in the South Atlantic. They would provide a springboard for actual attack against the integrity and the independence of Brazil and her neighboring republics. I have said on many occasions that the United States is mustering its men and its resources only for purposes of defense, only to repel attack. I repeat that statement now. But we must be realistic when we use the word attack. We have to relate it to the lightning speed of modern warfare. Some people seem to think that we are not attacked until bombs actually drop in the streets of New York or San Francisco or New Orleans or Chicago. But they are simply shutting their eyes to the lesson that we must learn from the fate of every nation that the Nazis have conquered. The attack on Czechoslovakia began with the conquest of Austria. The attack on Norway began with the occupation of Denmark. The attack on Greece began with occupation of Albania and Bulgaria. The attack on the Suez Canal began with the invasion of the Balkans and North Africa. And the attack on the United States can begin with the domination of any base which menaces our security, north or south. Nobody can foretell tonight just when the acts of the dictators will ripen into attack on this hemisphere and us. But we know enough by now to realize that it would be suicide to wait until they are in our front yard. When your enemy comes at you in a tank or a bombing plane, if you hold your fire until you see the whites of his eyes, you will never know what hit you. Our Bunker Hill of tomorrow may be several thousand miles from Boston, Massachusetts. Anyone with an atlas, anyone with a reasonable knowledge of the sudden striking force of modern war, knows that it is stupid to wait until a probable enemy has gained a foothold from which to attack. Old-fashioned common sense calls for the use of a strategy that will prevent such an enemy from gaining a foothold in the first place. We have accordingly extended our patrol in North and South Atlantic waters. We are steadily adding more and more ships and planes to that patrol. It is well known that the strength of the Atlantic fleet has been greatly increased during the past year and that it is constantly being built up. These ships and planes warn of the presence of attacking raiders on the sea, under the sea, and above the sea. The danger from these raiders is, of course, greatly lessened if their location is definitely known. And we are thus being forewarned. We shall be on our guard against efforts to establish Nazi bases closer to our hemisphere. The deadly facts of war compel nations for simple preservation to make stern choices. It does not make sense, for instance, to say I believe in the defense of all the Western Hemisphere, and in the next breath to say I will not fight for that defense until the enemy has landed on our shores. If we believe in the independence and the integrity of the Americas, we must be willing to fight to defend them just as much as we would fight for the safety of our own homes. It is time for us to realize that the safety of American homes, even in the center of this, our own country, has a very definite relationship to the continued safety of homes in Nova Scotia, or Trinidad, or Brazil. Our national policy today, therefore, is this. First, we shall actively resist wherever necessary, and with all our resources, every attempt by Hitler to extend his Nazi domination to the Western Hemisphere or to threaten it. We shall actively resist his every attempt to gain control of the seas. We insist upon the vital importance of keeping Hitlerism away from any point in the world which could be used or would be used as a base of attack against the Americas. Secondly, from the point of view of strict naval and military necessity, we shall give every possible assistance to Britain and to all who with Britain are resisting Hitlerism or its equivalent with force of arms. Our patrols are helping now to ensure delivery of the needed supplies to Britain. All additional measures necessary to deliver the goods will be taken. Any and all further methods or combination of methods which can or should be utilized are being devised by our military and naval technicians, who with me will work out and put into effect such new and additional safeguards as may be needed. I say that the delivery of needed supplies to Britain is imperative. I say this can be done. It must be done, and it will be done. To the other American nations, 20 republics, and the Dominion of Canada, I say this. The United States does not merely propose these purposes, but is actively engaged today in carrying them out. And I say to them further, you may disregard those few citizens of the United States who contend that we are disunited and cannot act. There are some timid ones among us who say that we must preserve peace at any price, lest we lose our liberties forever. To them I say this, never in the history of the world has a nation lost its democracy by a successful struggle to defend its democracy. We must not be defeated by the fear of the very danger which we are preparing to resist. Our freedom has shown its ability to survive war, but our freedom would never survive surrender. The only thing we have to fear is fear itself. There is, of course, a small group of sincere, patriotic men and women whose real passion for peace has shut their eyes to the ugly realities of international banditry and to the need to resist it at all costs. I am sure they are embarrassed by the sinister support they are receiving from the enemies of democracy in our midst. The Bundists, the fascists and communists, and every group devoted to bigotry and racial and religious intolerance. It is no mere coincidence that all the arguments put forward by these enemies of democracy, all their attempts to confuse and divide our people, and to destroy public confidence in government, all their defeatist forebodings that Britain and democracy are already beaten, all their selfish promises that we can do business with Hitler. All of these are but echoes of the words that have been poured out from the Axis bureaus of propaganda. Those same words have been used before in other countries to scare them, to divide them, to soften them up. And invariably, those same words have formed the advance guard of physical attack. Your government has the right to expect of all citizens that they take part in the common work of our common defense. Take loyal part from this moment forward. I have recently set up the machinery for civilian defense. It will rapidly organize locality by locality. It will depend on the organized effort of men and women everywhere. All will have opportunities and responsibilities to fulfill. Defense today means more than merely fighting. It means morale, civilian as well as military. It means using every available resource. It means enlarging every useful plant. It means the use of a greater American common sense in discarding rumor and distorted statement. It means recognizing for what they are, racketeers and fifth columnists, the incendiary bombs in this country at the moment. All of us know that we have made very great social progress in recent years. We propose to maintain that progress and strengthen it. When the nation is threatened from without, however, as it is today, the actual production and transportation of the machinery of defense must not be interrupted by disputes between capital and capital, labor and labor, or capital and labor. The future of all free enterprise, of capital and labor alike, is at stake. This is no time for capital to make or to be allowed to retain excess profits. Articles of defense must have undisputed right of way in every industrial plant in the country. A nationwide machinery for conciliation and mediation of industrial disputes has been set up. That machinery must be used promptly and without stoppage of work. Collective bargaining will be retained, but the American people expect that impartial recommendations of our government conciliation and mediation services will be followed both by capital and by labor. The overwhelming majority of our citizens expect their government to see that the tools of defense are built, and for the very purpose of preserving the democratic safeguards of both labor and management, this government is determined to use all of its powers to express the will of its people and to prevent interference with the production of materials essential to our nation's security. Today, the whole world is divided between human slavery and human freedom, between the pagan brutality and the Christian ideal. We choose human freedom, which is the Christian ideal. No one of us can waver for a moment in his courage or his faith. We will not accept a Hitler-dominated world, and we will not accept a world like the post-war world of the 1920s, in which the seeds of Hitlerism can again be planted and allowed to grow. We will accept only a world consecrated to freedom of speech and expression, freedom of every person to worship God in his own way, freedom from want and freedom from terror. Is such a world impossible of attainment? Magna Carta, the Declaration of Independence, the Constitution of the United States, the Emancipation Proclamation, and every other milestone in human progress, all were ideals which seemed impossible of attainment, and yet they were attained. As a military force, we were weak when we established our independence, but we successfully stood off tyrants, powerful in their day, tyrants who are now lost in the dust of history. Odds meant nothing to us then. Shall we now, with all our potential strength, hesitate to take every single measure necessary to maintain our American liberties? Our people and our government will not hesitate to meet that challenge. As the president of a united and determined people, I say solemnly, we reassert the ancient American doctrine of freedom of the seas. We reassert the solidarity of the 21 American republics and the Dominion of Canada in the preservation of the independence of the hemisphere. We have pledged material support to the other democracies of the world, and we will fulfill that pledge. We in the Americas will decide for ourselves whether and when and where our American interests are attacked or our security threatened. We are placing our armed forces in strategic military position. We will not hesitate to use our armed forces to repel attack. We reassert our abiding faith in the vitality of our constitutional republic as a perpetual home of freedom, of tolerance, and of devotion to the Word of God. Therefore, with profound consciousness of my responsibilities to my countrymen and to my country's cause, I have tonight issued a proclamation that an unlimited national emergency exists and requires the strengthening of our defense to the extreme limit of our national power and authority. The nation will expect all individuals and all groups to play their full part without stint, without selfishness, and without doubt that our democracy will triumphantly survive. I repeat the words of the signers of the Declaration of Independence. That little band of patriots, fighting long ago against overwhelming odds, but certain, as we are now, of ultimate victory, with a firm reliance on the protection of divine providence, we mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor.
Ladies and gentlemen, you have heard the President of the United States speaking from the White House in Washington. Tonight he has spoken of the grave situation now facing this country and has said that he has therefore proclaimed an unlimited national emergency. The President's fireside chats, of which this was the 16th, are usually delivered from the diplomatic reception room. But tonight he spoke from the beautiful East Room that he might have as his audience his guests of the evening, the diplomatic representatives of the Latin American republics. In his audience also were the Vice President of the United States and Mrs. Wallace, the Secretary of State and Mrs. Hull, the Undersecretary of State and Mrs. Wells, and the Assistant Secretaries of State, officials of the Pan-American Union, State Department Bureau Chiefs, and a few intimate friends of the President and Mrs. Roosevelt. The President and his guests will now retire to the South Portico and the Rose Garden for supper.
Well, that's the way it was on May 27th, 1941. Can you feel the tension in the air with all those newscasts going on? Boy, oh boy, oh boy, a lot of stuff was happening at this time. I'll tell you what we are going to listen to representing May 28th, 1941 in just a little bit. If you enjoy the content to this channel, please, please, please subscribe to this channel and click on that bell icon to get notifications. And also, I do this out of... out of pocket, basically. And I do ask for donations because this channel does not qualify for YouTube monetization. Now, how can you donate? Well, we have a PayPal account and a GoFundMe account. Whichever one you happen to be more comfortable with, you can donate through those. The links are in the expanded description section. So go down to the description section to this video and expand them. And if you don't know how to do that, go to the description section to the channel and you can expand that and you'll see the links there. Now, if the GoFundMe link is out of date on this video, go to a more recent video and you will find an up-to-date link there, or go to the channel description and that link will be up to date. I think the GoFundMe links time out after a certain amount of, time. This channel just won't qualify for YouTube monetization because we feature vintage music, movies, and radio. Now, let me tell you what we are going to listen to tomorrow night as we take a look at May 28th, 1941. Well, it's not as dramatic as today, not by a long shot. We are going to have just an average day of radio, no newscasts, but we do have the Goldbergs, the Adventures of Superman, the Lone Ranger, the Texaco Star Theater with Fred Allen, and an audition program for a show, an interesting program called I Want to Come Back. And it is a program dealing with felons who want to get their lives back together. Sort of reality radio, 1941 style. I think you'll find that rather interesting. By the way, I have three different audition programs for that show, and I don't think it ever made the air, but I do have three auditions for this show, and I will feature them whenever there's time. So until then, my name is Henry Chop, your host. Let's turn off this old tube radio. That's our time machine. Good night. God bless.
This changing world, this changing scene, where is it taking us? What does it mean? As long as we're certain of each other, we know we don't have to be afraid. These changing times we rise above. We have no time for them. We have our love, and love is the only thing that still remains the same through all this change.